janayana katam nayam atagatastanugritam anasavvidurat bruta prasidata mahanyavismayone. Translation: I called for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, desiring a son like him, and I thought of him only. But although he is far beyond the mental speculation of men, all three of you have come here. Kindly let me know how you have come, for I am greatly bewildered about this. Purport. Atri Muni was confidently aware that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the Lord of the universe, so he prayed for the one Supreme Lord. He was surprised, therefore, that three of them appeared. Text 29. Maitreya Uvacha Chittasya Vacha Shrutva Trayaste Vibhudarsamaha Prajahu Shlakshnaya Vacha Rahasya Tamrishimpravo. Translation. The great sage Maitreya continued, upon hearing Atri Muni speak in that way, the great deity smiled, and they replied in the following speak words. Text 30. Deva uchu. Yathā kṛtas te sankalpo. Bhāvyaḿ tenaiva nandita. Sat-sańkalpasya te brahman. The demigods replied, yathā, as, kṛtaḥ, done, te, by you, sańkalpaḥ, determination, bhāvyaḿ, to be done, tena eva, by that. Not otherwise. Sat-sańkalpasya. One whose determination is never lost. Of you. Brahmā. Oh dear Brahman. That which. Certainly. Dhyāyati, meditating, all of them, vayam, we are. Translation. The three deities told Atri Muni, dear Brahmana, you are perfect in your determination, and therefore as you have decided, so it will happen. It will not happen otherwise. We are all the same person upon whom you are meditating, and therefore, we have all come to you. Report. Atri Muni unspecifically thought of the Personality of Godhead, the Lord of the universe, although he had no clear idea of the Lord of the universe, nor of his specific form. Mahā-Viṣṇu, from whose breathing millions of universes emanate, and into whom they are again withdrawn, may be accepted as the Lord of the universe. Garbhodakaśāyī Viṣṇu, from whose abdomen sprouted the lotus flower, which is the birthplace of Brahmā, may also be considered the Lord of the universe. Similarly, Kṣīrodakaśāyī Viṣṇu, who is the super soul of all living entities, may also be considered the Lord of the universe. Then, under the order of Kṣīrodakaśāyī Viṣṇu, Viṣṇu form within this universe, Lord Brahmā and Lord Śiva, may also be accepted as the Lords of the universe. Viṣṇu is the Lord of the universe because he is its maintainer. Similarly, Brahmā creates the different planetary systems in the population, so he may also be considered the Lord of the universe. Or Lord Shiva, who is the ultimate destroyer of the universe, also may be considered its Lord. Therefore, since Atri Muni did not specifically mention whom he wanted, all three, Brahmā, Viṣṇu, and Lord Shiva, came before him. He said, since you were thinking of having a son exactly like the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Lord of the universe, your determination will be fulfilled. In other words, one's determination is fulfilled according to the strength of one's devotion. As stated in Bhagavad Gita 9:25, if one is attached to a particular demigod, one is promoted to the abode of that demigod. If one is attached to the kṛtas or forefathers, one is promoted to their planet. And similarly, if one is attached to the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna, one is promoted to the abode of Lord Krishna. Atri Muni has no clear conception of the Lord of the universe. Therefore, the three presiding deities were actually the lords of the universe in the three departments of the modes of nature, all came before him. Now, according to the strength, determination for the son, his desire would be fulfilled by the grace of the Lord. Om Trivanandasya Gyanna Salakya Chakshur Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Guru Deva Shri Chaitana Vanavistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Dhati Svapantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Padakamanam Sri Guru Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagrarvanatam Vitantam Sajivam Sagraitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sagana Dalita Sri Sakamvitamscha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Vidhara Sri Vasudeva Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Sincerity, because all these various deities reciprocated with him. So Atri Muni was certainly very sincere and determined in his purpose. And therefore, he was rewarded in an extraordinary way. And still, Atri Muni at the same time had incomplete knowledge. And due to his incomplete knowledge, his worship was also not complete. And therefore, this awkward situation came about, that his worship created results due to the sincerity, but at the same time was lacking in focus. It was lacking in relationship. It was, in one sense, impersonal. Although he was approaching the Supreme Lord, he had very little concept of who that Supreme Lord truly was. And as a result, he attracted the three presiding deities of the three modes of material nature, the guna avatars, within this universe, who appeared before him, and subsequently are blessing him that his desire to have a son like the Supreme Lord will be fulfilled. Srimad Bhagavatam is particularly establishing the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and is particularly establishing the identity of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. 10 subject matters are described in the Bhagavatam, atā, sargas, visargas, ca. First of all, the primary creation, secondary creation. So we are seeing how all the various universe, all the various planets within the universe are appearing, how all the universe appear from the boreholes of Mahā-Viṣṇu, how then Garbhodakaśāyī Viṣṇu enters, and so on. So in this way, we can see how at every step of the way, everything is connected to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There's no question that the creation just takes place merely by energies, but rather the Supreme Lord personally is involved at various steps and stages, and subsequently the secondary creation executed by Lord Brahmā again. A personality is involved. So Atri Muni understood that. He understood, he had knowledge that there was personality, that there was a supreme person who was behind everything. So he was not an impersonalist. He had a concept of a supreme person, but his understanding was very incomplete. And in that sense, the influence of impersonalism still remained, because he had no full understanding of who the Supreme Personality of Godhead was. Srimad Bhāgavatam is establishing the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We find that within our movement, the highest knowledge has been brought to those who are not very qualified, to those who are meager in their sincerity, to those who, in terms of their austerity, are not very able. I was writing a little bit, and in one line I wrote something about myself, that I definitely want love of God, but I don't really want to chant Hare Krishna for it. And, you know what I mean? I don't really want to pay the price, actually, if I'm very honest. I wouldn't. I'm miserly when it comes to that. All right, 16 rounds, yes. Extra rounds. All right, how many extra? Can I have it now? How much more austerity? How much more sacrifice do I have to perform? So my capacity for sacrifice is not so great, actually. And that is the natural inclination of all in this age of Kali. Very poor, poor capacity to perform sacrifice. So this is our predicament. Exceptions there may be, but in general this is our predicament. But Srila Prabhupada came and gave us such a clear sense of purpose, made it so crystal clear who the Supreme Personality of Godhead was, how he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By giving us Srimad Bhagavatam, and of course, not only giving us Srimad Bhagavatam, but giving us also the knowledge of the previous acharyas, giving us his purports, within these purports, including commentaries of previous acharyas. In this way, Srila Prabhupada then gave us, in full clarity, an understanding who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So our position is different in that way. Our movement is exceptional when it comes to understanding the goal of life. Even someone who is very inexperienced in devotional practices might be able to say the goal of life is prema pumarta mahan. The goal of life is to ultimately attain love of God. One doesn't have to be extremely learned in scriptures to be able to represent that conclusion, simply because of Srila Prabhupada's extraordinary mercy upon us. That mercy, of course, comes in the cyclic succession from Krishna, and all the great acharyas coming in this parampara have contributed to the clarity of that understanding. So Srila Prabhupada, first of all, gave us the vision of the goal of life. But then, because we are lacking in sincerity, lacking in our endeavor, lacking in determination, we find it very difficult, very difficult. We find this path so difficult, we lament constantly, we struggle. Many of us are not always capable of following even basic standards, what to speak of more refined instructions and injunctions. We're struggling like that due to our weak position in this age of Kali. Thus, Srila Prabhupada created also a movement which offered shelter in so many ways. A movement with temples. He offered us an engagement according to our level. In that translation that Srila Prabhupada read on that symbol of the holy name, and then that translation, he explains how this Kadamba mantra is coming directly from the transcendental plane and transcends the other planes, the intellectual plane, the mental plane, and the sensual plane. So these spheres are there. The sensual plane, the mental plane, the intellectual plane. At this stage, we are not able to rise above the sensual plane because we are very influenced by the body. Thus, in the process of devotional service that is offered to us, we learn to engage the senses in the service of the Lord. Risikena, risikesa, sevanam, bhakti, vichite. Simply engage the senses in the service of the Lord. Work with these senses in the service of the Lord. Engage them in devotional service. And work in this way through the senses for the pleasure of the Lord. And gradually, the other levels where the consciousness is also present, the mental platform, the intellectual platform, will become purified. And in this way, Srila Prabhupada gave a very practical program, not just a very complex philosophical program, not just a program of come to Vrindavan and meditate on Krishna's pastimes. What is our capacity to do so? Certainly we have come for that. In this month of Kartik, we have come to specifically enter into Vrindavan, to remember the Lord directly, not just that He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, not only that He is Maya Jakshena Prakriti Suyate Sacharacharam, the one who controls everything within the universe, but also to understand Damodara and how He comes in the form of a child, and how He acts simultaneously as the Supreme Lord and yet so human, simultaneously. This amazing feature of Krishna. So certainly we have come to contemplate and to meditate and to understand better here. And certainly Srila Prabhupada desired that we would do so. He did not wait in giving the 10th canto in a very early stage of the movement. He gave the Krishna movement. So certainly we've come for that. But at the same time, how can we understand? How can we understand the depth of the love of the residents of Vrindavan? When we are so shallow, when we have maybe a little attraction for Krishna, little attraction to hear about Krishna, but at the same time, so many other attractions also, and at the same time we are so strongly influenced by our material bodies and whatever happens within them. So that's why I felt that how great is our sincerity at this stage? Of course, this sincerity can grow by association, and that is another reason why we came here. Somehow or other, I had the good fortune of almost accidentally finding Vrindavan in my life, because I was traveling from west to east, overland, many times by magic bus, by hitchhike, by whatever went, and over mountains and valleys, and not only literally, but also figuratively, mountains and valleys. I won't describe everything that happened on the way. I was searching. I went in Afghanistan to Bamiyan, where they used to have statues carved out of the rock of Buddha, which were 35 meters high, and there was a tunnel, and you could go through the tunnel, through the Buddha, and you could go in, and you could then look through Buddha's eyes. I did. I looked through Buddha's eyes, and I tried to tried some Buddhist meditation while I was there. All is nothing, and from nothing all arises. And it sounded really intellectual, but I couldn't quite capture how. So, It sounded mystic, but I couldn't figure out what it really meant. So I tried that. I tried a few other things on the way, which I will not mention in this Bhagavatam lecture. And then somehow or other, after plenty of experiments and confusion, I wound up here in this place. I understood immediately that it was not an ordinary place. I arrived in the evening. The road was much smaller in those days. And as I walked towards Vrindavan, there were no cars, believe it or not. There were not so many. There would hardly be any cars. I was walking, and the only ones who were also going to Vrindavan were cows. So I was walking with the cows to Vrindavan. Whatever, I came here. And eventually, I joined this temple, and I stayed here. And of course, the mood in this temple is a little special. Because the mood in this temple has always been one of being close to Krishna. But what struck me even more than being in Vrindavan, where you sort of feel that Krishna was maybe just here, and wherever you are, in any place in Vrindavan, it is as if Krishna has just left around the corner. You know, it feels like that. You know, where did he go? He must have been here a few minutes ago. Vrindavan creates that impression. So yes, I had that experience. But stronger than the presence of Krishna here in Vrindavan, I felt the presence of Srila Prabhupada here in this Krishna Balaram Mandir, in this temple. It was the presence of Srila Prabhupada is everywhere in this temple. Very much so. Very much so. Here's the successor of the original tamal tree under which Prabhupada sat. It's like same parampara of tamal trees. And this parampara, I'm sure, will continue. And we remember that Prabhupada, without any question, that tree could not be cut, without a question. The whole temple had to be designed around that tree. How can one forget? How can one forget that Prabhupada sat here in his final days? How can we forget Prabhupada's house? I'm so happy that the paintings are back, right? And after a long time of separation from these paintings, they're finally back. And there's so many pictures in Prabhupada's house, and they're not just pictures that are put there for decoration, but many pictures were also gifts of different devotees from deities of their own temples. Well, they were not just gifts to decorate the room, but they were also attempts to remind Prabhupada, here's our deity, here's our temple. Please come. So there is so much presence of Srila Prabhupada here. Physical presence, his samadhi, his instructions, so many instructions. I was temple commander, and I became in charge of Srila Prabhupada's bell. Okay? That bell is such a thing. It has to ring on the hour and the half hour and during the aartis. But that's not everything. It has to be done by the chowki guards, by the security guards. And that makes it very difficult because they are sleepy by nature and many other things I can say about them. They're definitely not punctual. And it's very hard to keep them on time. And Prabhupada said, I will judge the management by the ringing of this bell. My God. The bell used to fall off, you know, just before the ring, and somehow or other, the ringing could never stop, you know, even if it had to be done with a hammer, but the bell would go on. Yeah. That was the spirit. Prabhupada's bell had to continue ringing, and every detail of this temple had to be taken care of. And every detail of this movement is is meant to be given that kind of attention. That is our debt. That is our service. That will be our saving grace. Because picking up from where we left off about our sincerity, if we don't have very strong sincerity in spiritual life, it may take us years to come to that point, to acknowledge it. I don't know how many years it might take, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, until we finally come to the point and say, maybe I'm not so sincere. Then what to do? Then our saving grace is just our service. Somehow or other, if we're just allowed to do a little service, that is our saving grace. If we can continue to do some service for Srila Prabhupada, in his movement, for his followers, for his devotees, then the connection is there, and the same, then our sincerity will increase, undoubtedly. Then within our heart, gradually, little by little, a little bit our desire to serve will increase. The nature of devotional service is that each service that we render is the preparation for the next, for a greater service. And each time we think that what I'm doing now is the real service, and then later, when we are allowed to do a greater service, then we realize, no, it was actually only preparation. It was only preparation for the service I'm doing now. So if we can only progress in this way, service, devotional service, is not just incidental, just like chanting Hare Krishna. It's not just based on sentiment, that one day I feel like chanting and I chant 64 rounds, and the next day I don't feel like chanting and I don't chant. And another day I feel like chanting again. No. Sankhya purva ganama gana nati bi. A fixed number of rounds. A fixed number of rounds means to take responsibility. To say, I accept this responsibility of chanting a certain number of rounds. So, this is a key element in the Sankirtan movement of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that devotional service means accepting responsibility. It means accepting some responsibility in service. Some responsibility to render some regular service. That's where devotional service becomes thick. In the beginning, our devotional service may be incidental. It may be very ethereal, interrupted. Yes, a little here, a little there. And there may be so many other desires in between that we try to fulfill. And then all these desires will also tint our devotional service with some personal motivation. But as our devotional service becomes more thick, sandralanda viseshatma, as it becomes more condensed, it means commitment. It means commitment. It means responsibility. It means to say, yes, I will do this on a regular basis. I will take responsibility for this service. In this way, vows of initiation are meant to help us to make that commitment, regular commitment. It is through that we gradually increase in our sincerity. Kuntidevisas janmaisvaya shrutisivi eidamadana manapuan naivariti akdatam vaitvam makinchana bhucharam. One must become materially exhausted, no longer caring for position of birth, wealth, beauty, knowledge. One must simply care about Krishna, about serving Krishna. That comes from taking such responsibility in devotional service. So that is our saving grace. If somehow or other we can see that Srila Prabhupada left us a great legacy. He left us a great movement. Many temples, so many books, so many things, so many programs. And then, what is our capacity? We are small and insignificant, but if somehow or other we could take responsibility for a little corner of that what Prabhupada created, and try, if we could, even develop it, then our movement would be strong. Then our movement will flourish. And then our own spiritual life will flourish. Then we will experience spiritual strength. And then our sincerity will increase. And in this way, we can really begin to understand a little bit more who the Supreme Personality of Godhead is. Because merely by hearing Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, we are greatly blessed, and yet we are so far removed from the goal. Still so far removed from the goal. Somehow or other, in this lifetime, also during the time that I was a devotee, or trying to be a devotee, whatever, a few times I was on the verge of death. A few times, really like on the very verge. As a devotee, when you're on the verge of death, it's interesting. It's sort of like you get... because it's all about yam yam bhāvyaḿ bhāvyaḿ, what you remember at the end of, or the state of consciousness at the time of death. So you get a test. So in one of these near-death experiences, I got a test and I realized that, yes, remembering Krishna is not so hard by Prabhupada's mercy. Because somehow or other, by His grace, by His divine grace, we have developed enough faith that Krishna is our shelter. So when you're close to death, Krishna, Krishna, yes, you want to think of Krishna because you want shelter. And so that wasn't so hard to think of Krishna. But what really struck me was, where's the love? Where's the love? Where's my love? Very poor. Where's my love for Krishna? And when I came out of that near-death experience, I was thinking that next time I will be in the same position, on the edge again. Next time I want to have more love for Krishna. And I've been thinking about that ever since. It's always in my mind, how to increase my love, how to increase my sincerity. And I appreciate that it requires many things. I used to be in charge of cleaning this temple. Have I cleaned it? I hosed it down and squeezed it out. That was one way. Now I'm not doing that. This time, I've come to really read the Krishna book. That also needs to be done. Prabhupada wrote it so that we would read it. So I've come to do that. The point is that somehow or other, I pray that little by little, dwarf step by dwarf step, I may take a little bit more responsibility to become a servant of Srila Prabhupada and his servants. And in that way, I hope that we'll come to this point to understand who Krishna is and then attain that ultimate goal of life. Prema Pumarta Maha, love of God. Now, love of God can be attained in this very lifetime or may not be attained in this lifetime. But I don't worry too much about that, because if one simply takes shelter of Srila Prabhupada and satisfies Srila Prabhupada and his representatives, then one becomes eligible to go back to Godhead. And somewhere on the way, love of God will be there. That's obvious. And exactly at what stage it will come, that we'll see. We can argue about that. But back to Godhead means then love of God will be there. So whether love of God will come here and now, it's the ultimate goal. But now my first meditation has become, let's somehow or other try in the servant of Srila Prabhupada. And then maybe, hope against hope, by his mercy, I will go back to Godhead. Maybe. And then love of God will be automatic. Just like when you go to the spiritual world, it is said that they speak Sanskrit in the spiritual world, but you don't have to study Sanskrit here, you know, so that when you arrive that you speak Sanskrit. That will come automatic. In the same way, even if you don't love Krishna here completely, once you're there, the love will be complete. So thus, I think Atri Muni, a great soul, very exalted, very sincere, but he did not have the same fortune that we have. We, not as sincere, but so fortunate. So fortunate that we got this mercy of Srila Prabhupada. And that is, if only we could somehow scrape up enough sincerity to take advantage of his gift. That's my lamentation. So I'll end with a lamentation. If only we could scrape up enough sincerity to somehow take advantage of his mercy. Okay. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any comments? Okay, the mic.
Thank you very much, Kadamba Swami, for the wonderful lecture. How to increase the love for the deities? You can just tell us a few points.
Well, first, it depends where we are. It's very difficult because we stand in front of the deities and we are attracted, but we are not like Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who became overwhelmed and felt like embracing the Supreme Personality of Godhead spontaneously. No. We are reminding ourselves, here is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But, again, by service, or by serving those who serve. We used to have here in the kitchen Vibhu Chaitanya, an elderly Indian Bengali man, who from the very early days began cooking for the deities. he cooked and cooked and cooked and cooked for 17 years non-stop. He never left the compound, never went outside the walls, never ever. Not even to cross the street. He never went outside the gate, never. He only went from his room to the kitchen to cook. It's like, he cooked everything. He cooked everything. All the offerings, including the sweets, including Mongolian sweets. Everything. You do it every day. I saw him with swollen legs for a long time until it came to a point he couldn't stand. I was temple president then, and it had come to a point he couldn't do it anymore. So I went to him and he was lying on his bed and he said, well, you know, maybe it's time to change service. Didn't say anything. Didn't want to hear it. And I told him that it's not going to be possible anymore. You're getting too old. Maybe you have to start giving out the charnamrita. That was a big mental adjustment. But then he did that. He did it. And then he did that with so much devotion. Krishna allowed him to leave. So he was so simple. I'm glad that when I was a new devotee, that they used to wash pots for him. I'm glad I did that. You know, because he had so much attachment to the deities. I'm glad I washed his pots. Because I hope that through that, maybe I've developed some attachment to deities, that maybe it will help. Like that. Let's serve the servants of the deities. I think he was there, it was first there and then good.
Thank you for a nice class. You said at the end that love of God will come automatically if we simply serve Śrīla Prabhupāda. But to really serve, first we have to surrender to serve. So surely we have to develop our love for Śrīla Prabhupāda and our love for the devotees. Then we can really serve. So how do we develop that love? Love for the deities, now love for Prabhupada and the devotees.
Lots of love this morning.
Lots of love.
That's what we really need, isn't it? That's good.
Yes. No, the word like automatically can obviously be explained in so many ways, and one meaning that can be given to the word automatically is you don't have to do anything. That's not what I meant, you know. Of course I had said the word responsibility previously, so yes. Well, our love for Prabhupada has to show in how much love means you are ready to put your own ideas aside for someone else, isn't it? When we love someone, we will put our own agenda aside and just try to please that person. And we'll do for that person whatever that person desires. So our love for Prabhupada has to show in how much we are ready to put our own agenda aside for and embrace his agenda. Do what is dear to him. That is where our love will show. And different people will show it in different ways. Some may cry, some may not cry at all, but it has to show in how much we are ready to change our life. So that's what we need to do, to think about what would Prabhupada really want me to be? And try and be it. And also ask the Vaishnavas, not alone, not high on the mountain all by yourselves, you know, what would Prabhupada want me to be? Also, Prabhupada speaks. Prabhupada also becomes known to his followers. They also, who can understand Srila Prabhupada? Like these days, we're hearing many reminiscences. But who can really say that he understood Prabhupada? Who can really represent Prabhupada? We hear stories about Prabhupada, but in a way, always falling short of capturing who Prabhupada really is. Because he's way beyond anything any of us can understand. We read his books, who can say they've understood Prabhupada's books? We've read them so many times. Who can say he understands? To some extent we understand, and to some extent we fall short, and we know. Therefore, if we understand that we fall short in understanding Srila Prabhupada, then with the collective, also taking input from the collective Vaishnavas, we can maybe understand better what Prabhupada would want us to be. And if we try to be that, then maybe our love for him will grow. A few blessings I also will help about from the Vaishnavas. Apurva Prabhu.
You say a little bit more about how by taking responsibility, this responsibility will convert or create the love of God that we're attempting to strive for.
Yeah.
Share a little bit with
you. Well, this responsibility that we are taking within this movement is to take care of something in Srila Prabhupada's movement. This movement is made of pure transcendental mercy. So therefore anything we do in this movement sincerely is blessing us tremendously. Then that mercy manifests itself on various levels. Mercy comes to us in a mystical way, by blessings from above, so to speak. And mercy comes also in a practical way. For example, in a practical way, by taking responsibility, we will be forced to get off the bodily platform. Because when we take responsibility in devotional service, all the pains, all the fatigue, all the mental agitation has to be put aside. It has to be put aside in the course of responsibility. And what we find is that in due course of time, our senses, which were so wild and raging and uncontrolled, have become controlled by just simply fixing ourselves in that service. One, by simply ignoring it for the sake of the responsibility, by ignoring the mind, by ignoring the senses for the sake of the responsibility. This I would call the practical purification, which we can sort of perceive, and we can see how it works. And then there's the mystic element of that mercy, where it becomes so fine that, you know, we cannot perceive it anymore. When Krishna smiles upon us, we don't see, but by taking responsibility in Prabhupada's movement, Krishna may smile upon us, and that will make a big difference. In this way, it is. I mean, even the word "very potent" wouldn't describe it. It is really our saving grace. it is, it's the only way we can do it. The only way. There's no other way than to take up devotional service. Although we say Harinam, Harinam, Eva Kevalam. That chanting is the only way. It means that we chant Hare Krishna and we serve the Hare Krishna movement. We serve the movement that is dedicated to chanting Hare Krishna. Because we cannot chant Kirtaniya Sadahari at this stage. I'm struggling with my little Kartik frat because I was a little sick the last few days. And boy, struggle, just to chant a few extra rounds, not even that many. So what is our capacity for Kirtaniya Sadahari? But because we are preoccupied with the body and the gross senses, if we engage these gross senses, that we can do. If you're good at calculations, calculate for Krishna. There's lots of things, account or whatever, you know. Whatever we are, use our senses, because that's where a lot of our energy is, on the gross sensual platform. And therefore, active devotional service by engaging the senses in this movement dedicated to pure chanting of Hare Krishna is also service to the holy name and will purify us and bring us to the point where maybe one day we will be able to come to Kirtaniya Sadahari. Who knows? Okay, I don't want to drag it on after 9 o'clock. I always feel that I'm over time, so I'll end here. Thank you very much. Śrīla Prabhupāda ki.